spurt that would have stained half the street.
Thank you, Holmes. I understand why you told me not to change clothes. Do you realize that our behavior didn't alarm anyone?
The victim's ordeal was even more discreet. By acting in silence, we have confirmed something. The crime definitely took place here. The victim and her murderer were able to come here without making any noise, and afterwards the murder took place without the slightest cry being uttered. Come, Watson, let's go home. We have spent far too long in this sinister alley. And so, my dear Watson, the day and night which we passed in Whitechapel were enlightening, weren't they?
An adventure that I most certainly will never relate, to be in the skin of that poor woman. I prefer not to speak of it further. But have we really learned anything about the murderer? Obviously a man, given the necessary strength.
We have little to go on, at least no more than the police. But in my opinion, Inspector Abeline has a trick or two up his sleeve. No, I want to talk about the facts and what we can draw from them. We know where the crime was committed and under what conditions. I would like to ask you about the possible motives for the crime. According to you, Watson, what could have pushed the murderer to act in such a way?
Okay. I do not know this one. What are possible motives of the crime? The victim suffered horrible motive, even if it's a field Sherlock Holmes doesn't know. Victim was an occasional prostitute without family or ties. So... love?
A personal drama.
Love can certainly lead to many a drama, but we have to consider the fact that the victim didn't know her attacker.
Okay. The victim lived in misery. So... madness. Okay, no. Revenge. No. Theft.
Theft, perhaps.
I have a hard time believing that someone would attack poor Polly so fiercely just to rob her of a few coins.
Okay, so victim suffer horrible something. Revenge? No, it's madness.
Homicidal insanity, Holmes.
It is indubitable that the man who did this to Polly Nichols is not of his full senses.
Incredible motive, even if it's a field of Sherlock Holmes and all. Black magic, basically.
Black magic?
Yep.
I'm not terribly interested in the occult or black magic. Let's give the benefit of the doubt to this motive.
Revenge, Holmes?
Revenge could be a possible motive, but with one small reservation. We have reason to believe that the victim considered her murderer to be a typical client.
A personal drama.
Oh, no,
love can certainly lead.
Okay. So, I'm good? What could have been a possible motive? Okay, resentment can be. There's no revenge. Madness. Maybe black magic. Maybe love. Let's do that.
Well, we are still missing certain information in order to finish this investigation, Watson.
Okay, whatever. Let me just look around here real quick. Isn't there stuff I was supposed to examine anyways? Oh, I can't do it no more? Yay. Not leaving. Okay, so, no, yes.
Elementary.
There you go. Okay.
Very well, Watson. I think that we've exhausted the topic. Take a rest and we'll speak again later.
Ah, it would seem that the investigation is advancing, Holmes. Yesterday's Star said that a suspect is in the hands of the police, a man with a rather sinister reputation.
I was about to join you in your optimistic outlook until you informed me that the good news came from the press, Watson.
But surely they wouldn't invent the fact that the police are holding a suspect or the acts that are attributed to him.
You will have an exact answer to these two questions in less than 50 seconds, Watson.
Pardon?
Enter, Inspector.
Oh, what was that? I saw that.
Good day.
Dear Watson, allow me to introduce Inspector Aberline. Inspector, Dr. Watson.
Inspector?
To what do we owe the honour of your presence, Inspector?
I heard that the two of you made your way to Whitechapel a few days ago. Your arrival, you are aware, coincides with a very serious affair which our police service is going to great lengths to solve and which is creating strong tensions in the area.
Pardon me, but haven't you arrested someone? A certain Leather Apron?
Absolutely not. The man who hides behind this name is indeed being actively searched for by the force. Besides, nothing at the moment suggests that he is the Bucks Row murderer.
There, you've been enlightened, Watson. Now it is our turn to answer Inspector Aberline's questions.
Indeed. I will be brief and precise. Do you intend to investigate this case, or have you already started?
It is to be of service to a friend that I went to Whitechapel. We did, out of curiosity, familiarize ourselves with the preliminary reports, and we made our way to the scene of the crime. Our conclusions are slim, as are the clues. Having not been officially appointed by a client, I believe that my intervention in this business will end there.
Very well. To be frank, you take the weight off my shoulders by distancing yourself from the case. Our image isn't very good, to say nothing of what the press puts us through. Thus, if overnight they found out that you were on the case, people would turn against us.
And they would pest me, overwhelm me, and finally make me out to be responsible for the inevitable failure such a scenario entails. Neither you nor I wish for this to happen. I know that your time is precious, Inspector. I will send you a note regarding my conclusions shortly.
With pleasure. Gentlemen?
Do you think that he will find the murderer?
The chances are slim to non-existent. It is 7 days now, short of a confession from the murderer himself.
And you will not go further?
You heard the Inspector, Watson. My presence in Whitechapel would hinder, which doesn't mean that we will drop the case.
How is that?
The Inspector spoke of me, but not of us. It is you, Watson, who will lead the investigation tonight. It is you who will bring to the police station the little note that I will write regarding our conclusions. Despite the late hour, there is nothing to stop you from making inquiries about this famous Leather Apron while you are there.
All right, Dr. Watson. Oh, shit. Leather Apron. The rain terror spreading through the district caused by the memory of murder of the unfortunate woman, Nichols, has no sign of abating. Many ladies of the night are living in the fear of Leather Apron. Mike, a shopkeeper in George Yard, knew Leather Apron for more than 6 years. It has confirmed to us that the man is undoubtedly mad, a fact that it is immediately apparent when face to face with the man. His eyes are shifty and restless, and he never looks anyone in the eye. Leather Apron lived in the loggings at the corner of his shop and was turned out a few months ago.
What? You still haven't left for Whitechapel, Watson?
Uh-oh. I already checked this.
There is
no... No, not Chelsea yet. So I have to go to Whitechapel now? I haven't even checked the other places. Let me see where this is at. This Sherlock's room. What? He has a wig? Where's the exit? Oh. Where am I going? I need to know. Letter Apron. Oh yeah, that's right. Spoke with me. Inspector spoke with me. None of us is you, Watson. Investigation. Bring the police station. Police station. Okay. So I gotta go there.
Well, if I follow Holmes's instructions, then to begin my investigation into this Leather Apron, I must first head to the police station.
Okay. Well, so let's go. Okay, what else is here? Can I check? Oh, you could. Dog, it's so dark I can't see. Alright, whatever. Let's talk to him.
Good evening, sir. What do you. I know you. You were here last week with Sherlock Holmes.
Indeed. I have come to bring a message from Sherlock Holmes for Inspector Abberline.
Very well, I will pass it on. But come to think of it, someone was asking about you recently. Finley, the caretaker of some shady boarding house nearby. Does that mean anything to you?
Ah, perhaps.
Okay, I can't know where that is.
Actually, I read in the Star that you have arrested a suspect called Leather Apron.
You shouldn't believe what you read in that rag, sir. The man is being hunted, but we have yet to get our hands on him, and we aren't close to it either.
Why ever not?
Bah, he's a specialist in the streetwalker racket. These girls make pitiful witnesses, and we don't inspire confidence. Furthermore, the man seems to be pretty discreet lately. Someone must be helping to hide him.
How to get on his trail, then?
One of these girls would have to confide in us and give a valid description of the man. Then we'd ask around the journeymen, who use aprons, I imagine.
What?
Well, goodbye. I must go to Finley's boarding house.
Oh, it's dark time now. What the hell?
Good evening, Finley.
Oh, good evening, sir. Aren't you the gentleman who was with the great detective the other time?
That is indeed me, Dr. Watson. Tell me, Finley, I was told that you were looking for us at the police station.
Indeed. I wanted to thank you for last time, you know. That vagrant has never set foot round mine again. I even found a tenant, one who pays his rent, I mean.
You don't seem very happy, but you were lucky to have found a good tenant so quickly.
It's just that this man is very strange. He paid several days in advance and I gave him a key to the place. Since then, he goes out every night and returns at ungodly hours. I'm sure he goes to visit the ladies, but still, every night. And when he moved in, something must have broken in his case and stank up the stairs in his room for 2 days. I think it was a jar. It must be over there.
Tell me, have you heard talk of Leather Apron?
By the papers, that's all. This man seems very sinister.
Do you know any journeymen who use this type of apron?
The slaughterhouse butchers, I believe, but definitely the cobblers. I know one, old Isaac Solomonovich. His workshop is on a small street in the Jewish community, across from the hospital. He's a good man. He can help you. But you know, the people there are very close and don't share much with non-Jews.
Racist.
Thank you, Finley.
At your service, sir.
This odour is very strong indeed. But the whole neighbourhood, as such, has a dreadful stench. Finley might have an idea as to what this jar that contained.
Now to go back.
What
to
do you want, Doctor?
You're right. The pieces of the jar that your tenant broke do give off a strange smell.
It's true. That's quite normal given his trade.
Yes, and what would the trade be of your strange tenant?
A doctor, like yourself, I believe. Dr. Tumblety, a foreigner. Canadian, perhaps.
Dr. Tumblety. It might be interesting to know more about him. Thank you, Finley.
At your service, sir.
Can I go to the house? What room is it? I don't know. Okay. So, I guess go to the hospital.
Tell me, is it...
You should return home, sir.
Fuck you. Who's that? Okay, where am I supposed to go now? I don't know where to go. Home button. clinic. Actually, yeah, clinic. Let's go there. Okay. Can we get rid of that bottle, please? Oh, I guess I'm just gonna have to hold it.
A cobbler shop.
Okay.
Closed. I will return later. The policeman said the street girls would know something about the leather apron. Maybe I should go and see Lucy.
Where's Lucy again? I think it's like right here. No, Lucy's not up here. Oh, I forgot where it was. It's Bucks Row. What the hell? I can barely see them. I don't know if I'm going the right way.
I have no reason to go that way.
Let's just do this. Actually, fuck it. Let's just do this. Teleport. Oh, I don't have her. Oh, here we go. Okay. There she is.
Oh, it's you. I'm coming. Dr. Watson, how are you?
Well, and yourself? And how's your uncle?
Well, he sleeps a lot, but he doesn't seem to be suffering. Your medicine has worked wonders. Thank you again.
It was the least I could do. I have come to see you about a certain leather apron. Have you heard of him?
Oh, yes, of course. Terrible things are said about that man.
Have you ever come across him?
Goodness gracious, no. But I know that he has threatened and taken many girls in my situation. I don't know what more I can say, but Bella would be able to tell you some.
Who is Bella?
Bella Pullman. She's the landlady of the place where I could take you there if you like.
Yeah, please
do.
Thank you.
It's me. It's Lucy. This gentleman would like to speak to Bella. It's the doctor who helped me. I must leave to return to my uncle. Thanks again.
The hell are you?
Out of the way. I don't like the look of you.
Okay, fuck you too then.
If you'd be patient, Madam Bella will arrive in a moment.
Good evening. I am Dr. Watson. It is young Lucy who told me to come see you.
Ah, so you're the good Samaritan who saved her uncle without asking for anything in return. And now you've come to see me, no doubt, to explain that the poor little thing doesn't belong here and you will see to her future. Well, if you expect me to let her leave with you...
It's not that, ma'am. You should know I am a married man.
And why should that matter?
I believe there has been a misunderstanding. The reason that Lucy sent me here is that you may be able to give me some information about leather apron.
Are you a doctor or a constable?
I am most certainly a doctor, but I am acting in this matter in a private capacity, and I would like to find this man.
Well, if you're able to rid us of him, I'll give you a week's worth of free passes. That man is a thorn in our sides. He spies on the girls in the streets and watches them inside the houses, spying through the windows.
Oh, hell no.
And as soon as they're finished with a client, he jumps on them without any warning and forces them to give him their money.
Jack the
Ripper? I've never seen him, but one of my girls was attacked by this man, and she said that he wore a leather apron and carried a knife.
Uh-oh.
And his face, oh, he has a horrible head, with rat's eyes and a deformed mouth. She even said that she knew his name, Pizer, or Pizer, I think. But I don't know where she can be found. Margie Nutcracker, the girl I'm talking about, could tell you more, but I had to let her go last week.
Why did you let Margie go?
The poor girl caught a shameful sickness, and the symptoms have attacked her face, if you know what I mean. So I gave her notice, and a little bit to help her along. I don't know where she is now, but she'll certainly be getting treatment at the clinic if she's still in the neighbourhood.
Did you speak to the police?
What would they do? Who cares about the girls in the streets?
Would you have received a visit from another doctor, a stranger by the name of Tumblety?
I'm just like you, Doctor. Sworn to secrecy in my profession. But as I've taken a fancy to you, I can tell you that this name is not unknown to me. And if you do me a little favour, it is possible I might remember something about him.
What kind of favour must I do for you?
You see that man over there? He's a rich artist, a painter, a regular client round here. Well, yesterday, he came and left his cane in the umbrella stand in the hall before going into one of the rooms. Well, when he returned to this room, the cane had disappeared. It's a cane with a massive silver knob. Must be worth a fortune. He threatened to call the police unless he got free services in my establishment for a year. I'll be forced to accept, unwillingly, of course, given the services that he's demanding, unless the cane is found.
Did you question the residents regarding the theft?
They didn't see anything, and there's not one of them that would risk stealing from a client here.
Who was in the room when your weasel of a client was in the chambers?
There were a few that came and went, but Mary could tell you better than I can, because she was the one at the counter yesterday.
Thank you, ma'am.
No problem, my angel.
Okay. So I gotta look at all the pictures before I talk to this guy.
These paintings are suggestive, at the very least. These paintings are suggestive,
all right.
At the very least. These paintings are
so it's the same thing.
Suggestive, at the very least. These paintings are suggestive, at the very least.
That's all he's gonna say?
These paintings
are...
Oh
my gosh.
Suggestive, at the very least.
Right, talk to the guy in a minute. Hold on.
These paintings are...
Suggestive?
Suggestive, at the very least.
Suggestive?
These paintings are... Suggestive, at the very least.
Art lover, suggestive. All right, so talk to them. Talk.